Hello, Nana here. Welcome back to Grim Dawn. We are playing on hardcore with our Drain Essence, a Death Knight. And today we are preparing to go face to face with the Loghorian. There's a couple of devotion shrines I'd like to pick up before we do that. We already cleared that one. But as I mentioned, there's the Black Sepulchre, which is somewhere off to the eastern side over here. We'll go there. Then I was thinking to just dip into the Bastion of Chaos while we are destroying the Blood Wagons, because there is a devotion shrine just before the entrance of the roguelike dungeon, so we can wrap that one up as well. And after that, it is going to be Loghorian O'Clock, so the ultimate end boss of the base game of Grim Dawn is very, very near now. So as such, in between episodes, I did have a bit of a look at my current gear. I just filtered through all the gear that we found last time, and turns out we acquired new pants. It's a good thing, you know, every once in a while, just update some of your gear. So now we have these. They have some elemental resistance on here, as well as a boatload of life and about 50% more armor than the old ones. So, of course, the old one had a lot of poison resistance, so ended up taking the molten hide out of the belt, putting anti-venom salve in there to swap the fire resist for poison resist. And as a result, we're now maxed out on poison still. And I think we even gained a little bit in fire, even though that was mostly a side effect. But we're now maxed on cold and on lightning. Important for the Loghorian is Chaos, that is at 61% resistance. The Loghorian itself will do a lot of Chaos damage. In addition to Chaos, there's going to be some physical. There's going to be some fire. There's going to be a little bit of lightning from one of the add-ons. There's going to be some vitality damage. And there's going to be a chunk of poison damage. So that's why I know the consideration here is to just keep the poison maxed. It was maxed. Now lightning is also, fire has improved slightly. But overall, the situation is pretty good. I dipped into my shared stash and I did manage to find some bloodbound ointments. So they will grant us 25% chaos resistance when we need it. So just before the Loghorian fight, that is something I can drink, just to make sure I'm just topped off at 80% chaos resistance. Alternatives would be, of course, to shuffle some components around, take some old ones out, put ones in that have chaos resistance, or maybe even have a look at the either the purified salt or the other one. Not purified salt. Oh, there's two. They're basically components. You can put them in your weapon or your offhand, and they grant you an aura that boosts. One is for ether, one is for chaos, and they boost your resistances quite a bit, as well as increasing your max resistance a bit. That is an option, but because we're really relying on the wrath stone in both a weapon and a shield to boost our damage, I think I'm just going with a potion is going to be fine. The Loghorian has no special resistances against ether, so in that regard, that's not really going to be too much of a problem. So I think we're good. Oh wait, we came from that side. Hello, Spanish. Just a long walk, circling all the way around, tagging the waypoint. More spiders, even more spiders. Oh, hey, you are blitzing, aren't you? I think you are. Also, I had a double check at my devotions, and I did notice that the proc ability for this little fellow in the corner here, it had actually fallen off. It was unassigned, a nice little question mark showed. So I'm happy I double checked that one. I've been shuffling around with gear so much, it was bound to happen, but It is part of our passive defense to help us stay alive in case things go slightly awry. So just before major boss fights, just make sure to double check those things so you don't get caught by surprise, guys. Well, on hardcore, those surprises can be lethal. Really depends on how much trouble you get yourself into and how much you really need the survival. In our case, I think in terms of defenses and defensive procs, what we're running right now is overkill for this early in the game. Especially now that Drain Essence actually does drain quite a bit. But in Elite, especially Ultimate, I'm gonna be happy that it's there. And even then, I will still want to just run out of combat from time to time. Plagueis the Decrepit. And of course, we're kind of leeching very much through him. Got a blue item and a bunch of components. And another strong box. Same treatment, two components. Okay, what did we need to put in here? Roiling Blood, that is pretty easy. Okay, so let's just not stand in there and then assign the point. We were working on the crane over here. Get a little bit of poison resistance out of it, which is a coincidence. 15 overcapped. Technically, I could unspend the Antivenom and put the Molten Shell, the Molten Fur back in just to get this one topped off and get this one at 75, but right now I just can't be bothered. And I know that the Crane is a temporary placeholder. Temporary. It's gonna be with us for quite a while still. But details of the plans there I did talk about last episode, so I'm not gonna rehash them. Okay, might as well just go here, stick to the right hand, and just work our way counterclockwise. Stick to the outsides, and then when we get to the Bastion of Chaos, we'll just tag it. Oh, hello there, Ketonian Dreadguards. And the Ketonian Vanguard. We will see more of you later in the Logorian fight. Everett the Bloodbound, he's burning. Well, that's good for him, I guess. This one kind of bit the dust rather quickly. Right now the challenge seems to be more of actually just managing to tag all the opponents rather than to survive. But once we've tagged them, they're dead. They're not gonna really get out of this alive in any way, shape or form. And Spectral Wrath, it still works pretty well. Okay, this is the bridge repair site. 40 scrap, 10,000 iron bits. I did think to bring some extra scrap. I wasn't entirely sure about the iron bits, but 10,000, I have that. So that is a good thing. So it's quite an investment for just effectively what's going to be a single devotion point. That's the only reason I'm going in here. But you got to do something for your points. Okay, we spawned on the left-hand side. The devotion shrine is always in the top of the map, and on the top left hand side of the map to be mostly precise. And the enemies are only a couple levels above me, 2 to 3 levels. It's not that bad. Could be worse, or could be a larger difference. But I guess since there's a devotion shrine here, they didn't want to make it too challenging. And on the minimap we already see it's a desecrated shrine, which is convenient since you have to fight there. Means you don't have to bring a specific component, you don't have to get out of here to fetch it or to craft it, because there's no components. It's very nice. Of course, this is a Chthonic area. You cannot spawn portals here. And we will have to find one of the randomly placed portals to get out of here on the way out. Okay, we'll just kick this one off. Just let's see, three heroes, that's gonna be fun. So you there, I'll just put my Mark of Torment on, and the rest can just try and punch me. One of them already fell flat, and they're gone. Okay, so while fighting or standing here, I'll just pick up the loot since I can't see any enemies. But look at that rain of gear. Another set of Brawler's Gloves. We did pick up another one of those last episode. And more scrap. And that is a devotion point. Relatively easily earned. And that gets us 15% to all damage. Which, well, it's not too shabby. Takes us to 1133 DPS. Let's see, earlier we picked up the Dreadnought footpads. Much more armor, some defensive bonuses, bonuses to blitz and blindsight, some pierce resist and physical resist, but the ether, chaos and elemental resist on the harvest footpads are just too tempting to pass up. And the amulet is a level 43 tempest sigil. That's completely not the damage types I'm looking for, so I'll ignore it. So the search for the way out commences, and luckily I did not have to find or look too far. It was right ahead. It's nice if you want to get out and you find an exit, and sometimes life is good in that way. So somewhere in the top here is gonna be one of these blood wagons, though that one was not it. A exalted stash, two green, three green items, and a blue item, and a higher tier component. That is a nice lucky find. It can be pretty lucrative just running around here, killing all the enemies, the Chthonians, the cultists, opening up all the treasure boxes. Life can be pretty good that way. Okay, so nothing is showing up on the minimap here, so I'm assuming we're relatively clear here, and it might be over there, and indeed it is. I think with semi-random spawns, not always where you expect them to be. The blood flows. Let's see, then we need to be over there. So. But you were shooting at me. I just cannot let that stand. How rude of them. Oh, good thing is we did pick up both of the devotions. We're now at the third of the shrines and we're not even 15 minutes into the episode. So that means it is now Loghorian o'clock. We'll just portal back to the waypoint because that's easier than walking. And gonna get downstairs into the lair of the beast. Face down at the big bad himself. On our way down here, there's gonna be a couple of levels and a couple of sub bosses. First one is gonna be a one of these void parasites, but slightly larger, slightly greener. Ooh, outcasts love me. How nice. The bosses become progressively harder, though. At least that was my initial assessment. Now, I think it might simply be a function of that they have different properties, and some of them are going to be easier for some bosses, for some characters, and some are going to be more difficult for others. The slug is relatively tanky, but the damage output wasn't that bad, I think. Next up is going to be a human sorcerer that is less tanky but does more damage. And then that is the final gatekeeper, of course, before we face the Loghorian. And corpse dust dropping from cultists. I Always thought corpse dust came from, well, walking corpses, not from living things. That's nice. I do like to put corpse dust into most of the jewelry on my characters. There is a loose torch here. And then we can get in here, get through there. Look. An ancient sarcophagus. Would it be trapped? Well, I don't really care, but there's loot. Loot, 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 loot. I do like my loot. More spawns, more loot. Fun thing is, oh, the enemies, they really can't do much here. Okay, cool. So that's quite a large section that is a secret. And I'm happy I found it. Not quite sure if this was actually my first time or if I had found it in the past, but I don't know, this game is so chock full of secrets, it is so easy to just overlook them and misremember where they are. But that one definitely was very rewarding. Hello there, Bingalgalor. So we'll just put a Mark of Torment on you. Standing in the middle of the poison might not be the brightest of things, but well, we're just tanking him. So I think we can get away with it. I mean, if I would be losing a lot of life, then obviously that was a signal that it was not a very bright idea, but wait, if you can get away with it, why not keep doing it? It works better than kiting around. Let's see, that door is boarded up, so we can go through here. Hello there, little ones. Use this one as a blitz target. There is a treasure chest with a door that eventually will open. So we'll do that. Go through here, walk around a little bit. Avalanche note, part 1. Oh well, we found part 2 and 3, but not part 1. So this is a door, there's a torch over there. I think... wasn't one of these rooms here originally the place where the boss was? I think the boss got moved. Or maybe he's got multiple spawn locations, that is of course an option as well. Apothecary touch, that's also a relatively common set item. I think this is the... second or the third one we've found in this playthrough alone. And ooh, look. Another one. Can't quite place where that one belongs to. Where is that for the way back? I don't know. Not entirely sure where it belongs to. Secrets, secrets, so many secrets. It is nice that a game that effectively has static maps, that even after, I don't know, I'm probably close on over a dozen playthroughs, there's still things in the game I don't know how they work. There's still secrets I keep discovering. Of course, it's going to be less and less over time. But they're still there. There's not many games that have level design that has so many little details and so many secrets that even after so long, you still haven't found them all. Yeah, I think normally this was the boss room that had the slug boss in it. Oh, what are you shooting at me? And then there's some treasure over here. Bit over there, but... oh wait, actually the door is openable from that side. So, of course, I gotta open the box. It's a small box, but it's a box nonetheless. One whole searing ember for my efforts. Okay, next level. If you are playing on softcore, then this is a good point to put down a portal. So if you die, you don't have to go through the entire first level. Level 43. It's always nice just level before a boss fight. In terms of energy management, we're doing pretty good. Slowly ticking down, we've got quite some stamina, but I think the damage we're dealing is pretty much all right at the moment. So what I'm gonna do is just put 2 points into my mastery bar and then put 1 point into blood boil over here. It's gonna make the siphon souls a bit more expensive, but it's not only 5 energy, that's not too bad. It's gonna add bleeding and vitality decay, and it's going to reduce offensive ability of enemies affected by it. So effectively we've improved our defenses a little bit, because of course if enemies have a lower offensive ability, they're gonna hit and crit me less often. And if I manage to reduce their offensive ability enough, or increase my defensive ability enough, kind of interchangeable, then of course they can't even crit me anymore. Because there simply will not be accurate enough to manage that. And I think my defensive ability is pretty good, 1100 versus only 900 in the offense. I'll just keep boosting my spirit, since in the physique department we're doing pretty good. And it is very well possible that for the remainder of the game we'll just keep putting points into spirit. And that it's just gonna get boosted along that way. Because right now, the rule of thumb I set for myself to make my physique equal to 11 times my level. We're pretty much over that, and as we keep boosting the mastery bar, we'll keep getting more physique. And on the soldier side, there's some passives that we're eventually gonna boost all the way to max. That will actually increase physique by a percentage. So we're gonna get quite some out of that as well. Hello everybody. So that Siphon Souls, that green flash, range is relatively short right now. It's because it's not only a one pointer. Eventually I want to max that one as well. And at large range, it's gonna hit a lot of enemies. And it is gonna be pretty effective that way. Also, this is a dead end because the door there is blocked. So we'll have to go back to the other side here. Eventually we have to be somewhere in the top, so I try to steer towards the right hand side of the map, but sometimes if the way is blocked, you can't really brute force your way through. I mean, we're powerful, but we're not powerful enough to overcome doorways. No, they do remain the greatest foes of all the heroes in all the games. No, I think in defense of the game here, they are boarded up doorways. No, they are sturdier than just your regular old, hey, you need a key for this doorways. Okay. There we are. Oh, that strongbox. I think I could get used to this. No boxes, always having at least something useful in them. Does make you if it's a consistent reward for always for opening them, life's gonna be pretty good, and you always look forward to them, and you'll take the effort of actually opening them. I mean, if it's only a small chance of getting something nice, then you're less likely to take the chance. I wonder, once we make it to Elite and Ultimate, if we're gonna see more and more blue and legendary items as a result of the changes. I mean, I haven't played on any high level characters since the 105 patch, so I'm not sure how that works. But nope, I'm always curious to hear about your experience. So if you have noticed a substantial change in the drop rate of elites and legendaries in the higher difficulties, then please do drop me a comment. So here is the final Guardian Bloodlord Athalonis. The add-ons that he's summoning, they just died as a side effect of just being here. And he dropped a Skull Relic. I accidentally clicked a weapon, re-equipped it, so I dropped my aura off. Let's just double check that my devotions are still in order. And they are... Oh yeah! Wait, I attached it to Defy Death, but Defy Death is not an aura, is it? It's a life-saving ability that's gonna be... I'm not entirely sure if that's gonna be the best one. Let's actually just put it back on one of the weapons. That aura is up, that is a bit more reliable. So, Squall, that is one I don't know yet. Level 25 relic. That has a lightning storm that you can cast. Okay. Neat. So, we'll just put this one over. Compactize this, and then there's space for some drops from the boss fight. So, we're gonna drink the Bloodbound Ointment. It's gonna be up for 450 seconds. Actually I need to drink it, not wanna change it. And then we're gonna go into the fight with the Logorian. Let's do this. Ogrim, poohoo. I'm gonna help you, buddy. We're gonna help you. Okay, there's a chaos storm thing underneath my feet. It does not look impressive. But of course this fight, it's not the Logorian. Not really. Okay, so Mr. Dude died. And we got some add-ons. This is the true fight is of course with the add-ons, not necessarily with the Logorian. Okay, unique add-ons have been murdered. Now we can go back here. I think Spectral Wrath might actually help us deal with the tentacles, because they just pop. Quite literally, they pop. So, energy management is something I have been talking about, and here you see it in a longer, more sustained fight. Our energy is slowly draining. I have not yet used a health potion or an energy potion, nor have I actually drunk my or used my overguard. Trying to use that as a panic button. Can we get him down before the energy is out? And that worked. Wonderful. Well, that was pretty effective. So, loot here, loot there, even more loot over here. Oi, no falling off the edge. Haha. I'm happy that we at least had some space in the pockets for all the loot. Then it's gonna be a while before we see the face of the Logorian again. Don't have to wait until the Chaos Realm, where we will also meet Ulgrim again later. For now though, ding dong, the Logorian lies dead. And we can go over to Fort Icon. And next step in the journey is going to be the Hidden Path. So that's gonna be the next episode. Face down the three guardians, and then the temple. The lore we've already done in previous episodes, so we're gonna ignore that one. Well, we'll have a look at the legendary items soon as well. But never mind, continue. Lots of talking, and we'll head over to the Uchtenburg, and we got some quest items, and another in journey, and some people says that want to have their father rescued. Well, we'll indulge them. So, another Queen Inquisitor thing. Okay, so quest items, might as well move those over as well, and then have a look at the purple we earned. Wendigo main leggings. Bonuses to vitality and bleeding damage, as well as vitality decay. So that's a bit of an overlap. Vitality is useful. Offensive ability, we can always use more of that. Physical resist, that is nice. Pierce and vitality resist, that's also pretty neat. We're maxed out on vitality, we're maxed out, nearly maxed out on pierce, but we think we can shuffle some things around. +2 to siphon souls and +2 to blood boil. That is siphon souls, blood boil. So that's the skill I was wishing already that it was higher a level. Siphon souls, 25% chance when hit. In a ghastly release. So that's the skill we have been using. And this is gonna trigger it. 25% chance when you get hit. 5-second recharge, 3-second duration. I think that's pretty nice. Now just passively having some health regen kick in, or some life leech kick in, that also does damage and synergizes with our main elements. I think this is pretty nice. Now once we hit level 50 in 7 levels, we can definitely have a look at this. Zolhan's Battleplate, that is more of a soldier thing than a Death Knight thing. Armor is double what we have, but damage types are a mismatch, so I don't think this is gonna be too much of a win. Skin Flayer Raiment, that's more vitality and bleeding damage and vitality decay, so along the same line as the pants that we found. More damage to humans, yes, kill all the humans. There's quite a lot of them in the game, so that is convenient. Some extra health, some offensive ability and some energy regen. Sigil of Consumption is Occultist, Wendigo Totem is Druid, Shaman. So, another match. So, nope, nice idea. Execution not entirely appropriate for us. But, we did manage to defeat the end boss. Make it through. So, for next episode, as I said, we're gonna do the Hidden Path. And after that, we're gonna start on the expansion content on the other side over here. But for now, I'm simply going to thank you very much for watching. And I hope to see you again next time. Bye bye.